Okay, folks, so let's talk some Oscars.
I'm always ready to talk Oscars.
Oscars 1996, of course, were the Oscars that honored the films of 1995. And, you know, the funny thing is, we're not talking about hardly any of these movies that we're about to talk about.
I noticed that when I pulled this open to review. I was like, that's funny. We're not really talking about any of these actual movies on the Oscar list this year.
For some interesting reasons, I think. So let's just get into it. Big winner of the night, Oscar night 1996, was Best Director and Best Picture went to Braveheart, directed by the odious Mel Gibson. Yes. Trash. Ugh. Yeah. And, you know, quite frankly, I just didn't want to have to watch all 5 hours of that fucking movie again just to talk about it because it happened to win an Oscar. Him and his stupid blue face. I'm just, you know... No, pass, cancel. So
I never saw it, and I'm going to live in a world where I maybe will never see it. So I'm cool with that too.
I mean, at this point, it probably wasn't bad, but at this point, I watch Mel Gibson on screen, and I just hate him so much that I can't even focus on anything else. So it just dims my enjoyment of watching the movie.
I'm going to throw out there, it was actually a good movie. I did enjoy it. If you don't like that kind of film, then don't waste your time with it, Allie. And yes, he is still an odious person, but I can't deny that it was actually a good movie.
Yeah, I'm not denying that it was a good movie. I mean, when I saw it, when it came out, I kind of enjoyed it. But it was very soon after that that he came out with all of his homophobic bullshit. And I was like, okay, I'm over you. And now I can't look at him without being angry. And it's not because I really don't believe in cancel culture. Like, it's like if you want to watch something, and we're about to talk about a movie this season that, you know, 3 or 4 people who were involved with it have all been canceled. And I can still watch the movie and it's fine, you know, but with Mel, it draws a line. So no. Best actor that year went to Nicolas Cage for Leaving Las Vegas, basically watching him fall down an alcoholic spiral.
Never seen it.
It was based on, what's his face?
Was it a book?
Yeah, it was, who's the author? Johnny Depp loves him.
Fear and Loathing?
Oh, Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas guy?
Yes. Yeah.
Hunter S. Thompson.
Yes.
Yeah.
Or maybe wasn't it based on him? Or maybe I'm thinking of something else.
No, I don't think so. Because I think most of his stuff was really just autobiographical. It was almost like journalism/novel. I don't know. We'll have to look into that. But anyway, he played a drunk and we just watched him get drunker and drunker and drunker. And Elizabeth Shue played the most wooden hooker in the entire world.
That's the name of my memoir now. Wooden Hooker. Allie Jenkins.
So anyway, and then complete, you know, on the other side of the spectrum, best actress was Susan Sarandon as a nun, because, you know, no one's more nun-like apparently than Susan Sarandon. Okay.
I never saw that movie.
Opposite Sean Penn in Dead Man Walking. You know, Sean Penn was on death row. She was a nun. He kept saying he didn't do it. Her whole mission throughout the whole movie was to get him to confess and repent. And he does. And then they kill him.
Oh.
And she cries. End of movie. I mean, it's...
Okay.
Yeah.
I forgot I had seen that.
thank you for the two-set tour, and I'm good.
The Screenplay Awards were doing both of these movies, so it's maybe that just says something about us, and we like good writing. Adapted screenplay, Emma Thompson for Sense and Sensibility.
I love her.
Which is a lovely script. I love her in general. Best original screenplay was Christopher McQuarrie for The Usual Suspects.
Great movie.
Which we will be talking about as well. And then other Oscars of note, just because they happen to coincide with what we're talking about this time. Kevin Spacey won Best Supporting Actor for The Usual Suspects. And Apollo 13 won a technical award for Best Sound.
I mean, I've never seen Usual Suspects, and I know there's a twist. I don't really know the twist. So I'm very much looking forward into sort of going into that kind of blindly.
I cannot wait to get your response to the twist. I will not give you any clue as to what it is. I will say that when I watched The Usual Suspects in the movie theater, I dropped my soda and it went everywhere. I was so shocked. It fell out of my hands. It was like, what the up? It was amazing.
And I feel like you're not a shocker kind of person.
The thing about this is it didn't even, I can't say anymore. We'll talk about it when we talk about it. But anyway, those are the Oscars, folks. I mean, we have a love-hate relationship with the Oscars here. It's like sometimes it's a really good year and there are too many good nominees. And just the fact that you didn't win does not mean that you're a worse movie than the one that won the year before, because sometimes the one that won the year before was horrible. And then sometimes we have Crash, which just sucks completely and won Best Picture. So whatever.
Yeah.
Anyway, the year of Mel Gibson.
Ugh.
We hate you, Mel.
This is the Rewind Project. I am Eric.
I'm Allie.
I'm Matt.
And this week we are talking about one of my favorite movies from 1995. You're about to get the squishy side of Eric, because this week it is Sense and Sensibility, directed by Ang Lee, written by Emma Thompson. So this is always the thing I go back to, right? Emma Thompson is the only person, not just the only woman, I love saying the only person ever to win Oscars for both acting and writing.
That's shocking to me.
It is. I mean, it is surprising. But when you think about all the actors that have won for their screenplays, none of them are really all that great actors. I mean, you know, so they're well-known actors, but they're not like Oscar-winning actors, you know? And so, but this is always the one I go back to, because there was a little bit of controversy about this Oscar for Best Screenplay for Emma Thompson. There was I don't remember what the competition was. I probably should have looked it up. But there was this whole thing about, well, did she really deserve it? But the point is that nobody had a prayer against her this year, because in the Oscars, you nominate according to the category that you belong to as part of the Academy. So, you know, Matt, if you were a writer and Allie, you were an actor, when it comes to the nominations, Matt would nominate for screenplays. You would nominate for actors. But when it comes, when the nominations are announced, everybody votes for everything.
Then it's a free-for-all.
And because the acting wing of the Oscars is so huge,
powerful,
if you are an actor who gets nominated for either Best Director or Best Screenplay, you're going to win. Unless everybody hates you. Unless you've made a lot of enemies and everybody hates you,
right,
you're going to win that award. You know? And so Mel Gibson, right? No one had a chance.
Right.
And maybe they didn't realize how much of an asshole he was at the time. I don't think he'd win an Oscar today.
God, I hope not. Ugh.
But, you know, and it kind of surprises me that, like, Jodie Foster never won for writing or directing something. She kind of became a filmmaker after a while.
She's a good director.
And that might be a little sexism that went into that, too. But anyway, you know, when Emma Thompson was nominated for this, first of all, she's brilliant and the script is great. Secondly, everybody loves her. Like, everybody just loves her. Anyone who's ever worked with her loves her. And so, bada bing, bada boom, you get an Oscar. So anyway, that was the big notable achievement for this. It was also nominated for a bunch of Oscars. This is the only one that it won was the screenplay. It got nominated, though, for Best Picture, Best Director, Ang Lee, who also directed Brokeback Mountain.
I love Ang Lee. I love his aesthetic. I love the way that he sort of approaches the shots. I love everything about him.
And I just, you know, I kind of wonder about, you know, I think sometimes that these period pieces are better done by someone who's not of the culture that is being, because they have a little bit more like an observing eye, as opposed to, they don't take things for granted. I mean, I think that Ang Lee probably knew, I don't know a thing about 19th century England, so I'm going to depend on all the experts around me to get the costumes right, to get the sets right, to get the mannerisms right. And then once I start looking at what it is, I can start seeing what's nutty and crazy about some of these customs and really point at those with the camera, you know, as opposed to having someone, you know, even like me, I would probably, you know, I'm not a film director. I would certainly be but I would probably take a lot for granted. Like, I know what's going on because I've seen, you know, because it's quote unquote my culture, even though it's not.
Right.
Does that make sense?
It does. Yeah. And I mean, I think of the way the one shot was framed that was sort of far back and you can see the horse riding and I'm like, it's so brilliant. Like, that's not something that you would see in a period piece is a very like artistic shot like that.
Yeah. So cinematography also got an Oscar nomination. Costumes because, you know, period pieces are, you know, the score was nominated for an Oscar, as well as nominations for Best Actress for Emma Thompson and Best Supporting Actress for Kate Winslet. They probably both should have been nominated in the lead category, but, you know, movies will do that. Like, let's campaign one in one and one in the other, and we have a better chance of winning.
Break it down.
So a lot of times I think that the supporting category is filled up with people who should have been nominated for lead, but
wasn't.
There was a decision made about they'd be more competitive in this other category, and so it's all bullshit. I think it's a great category to have, because I think that if you didn't have it, a lot of really great, great actors would never be noticed. But anyway, that's that.
So I'm nodding, and you can't see me on the Zoom, but I am nodding, and I am agreeing. So I have a confession to make.
Yes.
It's a little embarrassing. It's actually probably a lot of embarrassing.
It's a safe space. You, me, and the whole internet, Allie.
Safe space. So I thought I had seen this movie before, but I hadn't seen this movie because I was equating it with the Much Ado About Nothing by Kenneth Branagh, which is an entirely different author. I hadn't seen this movie before. And when I turned it on, I was like, I don't remember this.
You had never seen this movie before?
Never seen this before.
You're not the only one.
I thought I had seen it. I was thinking about the Kenneth Branagh Much Ado About Nothing, which I have seen. Totally different genres, everything. But no. So it was brand new for me when I watched it.
Yeah, so no flowing white cotton dresses in this
no
one.
No sword fighting.
Yes, and no suntans. And no Denzel. Like, Denzel is a big miss.
Yeah. It was not the movie that I was expecting to watch, but it ended up being delightful. But yeah, I was like, oh snap, Allie.
And you'd never seen it either, Matt.
Confession: I was doing the same thing because I have seen Much Ado About Nothing with Kenneth Branagh, and I thought I had totally seen this movie.
Okay, well, you know, Much Ado About Nothing was filmed when the marriage between Kenneth and Emma was at a much happier place.
Yes.
This movie was made after the split had happened, and apparently amicable enough. I mean, you know, I've seen them together since, and they're not, you know, but he did cheat on her, famously, with our favorite Helena Bonham Carter, when they were
making
the dog of a movie, Frankenstein, which, you know, not Helena's finest moment at all. I mean, she was fine, but the movie was awful.
Yeah. Is that Mary Shelley's Frankenstein?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
And Robert De Niro played the monster. I remember watching that movie with friends, and we were like, but it's Kenneth Branagh. How bad can it be? And about 10 minutes into it, I looked at my friends and said, if we're not allowed to start making fun of this loudly, I have to stop watching.
Yeah.
Because the only way to survive this is to... It was terrible.
That's how I feel about Bram Stoker's Dracula.
Yeah.
The one with Keanu.
That was better, though, than the... It was
a little bit better.
I mean, it was just... Ugh. But anyway, Sense and Sensibility was made long after the split, and she met her new husband, and they're still together. That's a nice, you know, little... The two movies that we remember. Yes, yeah. It's like, you know, this one was the new beginning, where she met her dashing new beau, who plays an asshole in the movie, but, you know, he is, but he's dishy, and apparently he's a much better person than he played on screen. So here's the plot. There are these two sisters who used to be rich and now have nothing. Jane Austen employs this plot device a lot, where women cannot inherit, and therefore, even though you may be of the class of the landed gentry, you don't have the resources, you don't have the funds, and you are poor, not really poor. I mean, not really. You know, I still looked at Barton Cottage. I'm like, this was the huge downgrade. I'm like, six times bigger than my house, so whatever. Yeah,
you're not Oliver Twist poor. Like,
exactly. Exactly. But in the world that they came from, you know, they are, and so they have all the mannerisms and a lot of the expectations, and they know how to navigate high society. They just don't have the resources any longer. So they are kind of demoted to not very marriageable. And of course, all of these, even though Jane Austen herself never married, all of her books seem to be about, will these girls ever get married? And will they have to marry somebody horrible, or will they be able to marry somebody great? And of course, it always works out. So once rich, now penniless, they are kind of navigating both class and marriage. One is very pragmatic and prudent, and the other one is a little wild and has lots of romantic sensibilities, hence the title Sense, Emma Thompson, and Sensibility, Kate Winslet. They fall in love, have their hearts broken. One of them almost dies, but of course it's Jane Austen, so we get a happy ending. And it's very funny and very witty, thanks to that Oscar-winning script by Emma Thompson. There are a lot of differences between the book and the movie. I've never read the book.
I've not. I've only read Pride and Prejudice is the only Jane Austen book
okay.
I've
read. This is generally considered, from what I've read on the internets, which of course are to be believed in every...
All the time, 100%.
This is kind of considered to be the weakest of her major novels that people really? Have heard of. Pride and Prejudice is the kind of the pinnacle of her comic work. Her later work, Mansfield Park, Persuasion, she got a little bit, you know, she left some of the sense of humor to the side and told
got a little emo
stories. But and Emma, of course, is very well regarded, and we're going to be talking about that one next week.
Yes.
But Sense and Sensibility was her first novel, and so she was getting her feet wet, trying some things out. And I think that that the movie is fantastic, and I think that Emma Thompson filled in a few spots where maybe Jane Austen had not quite, you know, had she kind of created something pretty amazing out of what is considered to be a book with some flaws. So let's get into the cast. Oscar nominee for Best Actress, Emma Thompson, who of course had won in years previous for Howard's End, plays Elinor Dashwood. The only thing to fault really here is that Elinor in the book is 19 years old.
I was going to ask about that because when I was watching the movie, I was like trying to figure out how old they were supposed to be in the book, how old they were in real life. Like, what was the age difference between Kate Winslet and Emma Thompson? Like, I was doing all of those machinations in my head.
Yeah. Yeah. In the book, the two sisters who are kind of at the center of the story are 19 and 17. So 2 years apart. And, you know, I think the only thing that I think is confusing about casting Emma Thompson, who is so much older, is two. One, it should be really obvious there's a huge age difference between the first family and the second family.
Mm-hmm.
So the son should be noticeably older. And he really wasn't. I mean, not noticeably older. And the second thing is, by the time you're Emma Thompson's age in the Jane Austen period of the 19th century, if you weren't married yet, you were over the hill. It was not
Minster City
going to happen for you. At the same time, Elinor is a very specific character, right? And you have to be really smart. You have to tell the audience that there is a heart beating underneath this very placid, pragmatic exterior. But it has to be somebody who everyone around them just kind of notices, and it's mentioned all the time, that Elinor is not one to get carried away by her emotions. And she needs to be smart, and she needs to be funny, and she needs to be a lot of things. And not to say that there's no 19-year-old in the world who could have handled it, but you don't get much better than Emma Thompson.
I mean, you got to have that gravitas that she brings, that sort of like drawlness. I mean, not to make this like Sex and the City, but I am definitely an Elinor in life, so...
Yeah,
I identified a lot with that character as she was going through. I was like,
yes, and me too. I mean, it's just one of those things. Like, you know, I think you and I, Allie, both have, like, you know, we do have that internal romantic sensibility, but on the outside, look, you know, and we tend to kind of say they must have had their reasons. There must be a reason for that. I don't think I keep secrets nearly as well as Elinor does. I can't believe.
No, I definitely do not.
That when Lucy dropped that bomb halfway through, that she didn't run to her sister and say, guess what? But, you know, if she had, there would have been no movie. So that's fine.
I mean, I'm pretty good to my word, but like, that's a juicy secret. And I don't know if I would have kept that to myself.
Yeah. Yeah. So Kate Winslet played Marianne Dashwood, who was the wilder, more romantic, wears her heart on her sleeve kind of person. This was one of Kate's first, you know, big things. She'd been in Heavenly Creatures before. So film lovers kind of had recognized her, and she played a half of a murderous quasi-lesbian Australian pair of schoolgirls in that movie. And she was great, by the way. I don't know.
I love that movie. No, I love that movie. Yeah.
Yeah. She's so good. But, you know, so here she is in this one kind of making a big splash. And I think everyone kind of went, who? Obviously pre-Titanic, pre her Oscar, which she finally won for The Reader, and a lot of other great things that she has done. I thought she was lovely.
She was great. And I mean, look, it's like written into the canon of British actors that you have to be in some sort of 18th, 19th, 17th century period piece before you become big or after you become big. So this was, you know, this was hers. It's like written into the law in Britain. Exactly.
Well, you know, it's funny because as I was going through the cast and looking at like, who do I know these people from? Who do I know these people from? What I've noticed is that the canon really is, you know, as far as British actors, Game of Thrones, mm-hmm. The Crown, Downton Abbey,
Harry Potter, Midsummer Murders.
They've all been on Midsummer Murders.
Yep.
So, you know, that's kind of, if you're kind of a not the A-list Hollywood British actor, you've done a guest role on Midsummer Murders. But yeah, there's this whole, like, you know, there's big series that seem to cast every British actor under the sun. And, you know, Emma Thompson and Alan Rickman were both featured in the Harry Potter series.
Yep.
As were many of the others
and Gemma Jones.
On our list. And Gemma Jones and Elizabeth Spriggs.
And Imelda Staunton.
She's
the best one.
And Robert Hardy. I mean, so many of these, you know, were in that. So we'll get to all of them. Alan Rickman, R.I.P.
He's my fave.
I love him so much.
So much.
And this is one of the only times this one and Truly Madly Deeply are the two movies where he just got to play romantic leading man-ish. I mean, he's not in a ton of this movie. It's really more about the women than it is about the men. But he is one half of the kind of romantic pairings that kind of come around in this movie. And he's the one who's not, you know, he's got competition. Hugh Grant didn't have much competition for Emma Thompson. It was either to Hugh Grant or not Hugh Grant.
Which is great. I would like to be in the middle of that one.
Right? But you know, this one, he had some competition for Marianne's affections. But he was, you know, the staunch Colonel Brandon, who again is probably more like Elinor, right? Like, doesn't wear his heart in his sleeve, but the audience has to know how he feels without him sharing that with any of the other characters on screen. And Alan Rickman is just, he's so good.
So good. Just his facial expressions that you just don't, he doesn't have to say anything and you know what's going on in his mind and, you know, you can see it in his eyes and on his face and, ugh.
Oh, that scene where he brings Kate Winslet some flowers and then the neighbor with the big mouth basically just names the elephant in the room and says what's on everybody's mind. And just his face just falls.
Yep.
Just a little
bit. Just a little bit.
Like, he hasn't given up his dignity. He hasn't, like, you know, he hasn't done anything embarrassing, but you can just see his heart breaking, like, right in his face. And it's, he's so good. And that voice, I mean, it's just, there's something about, you know, it can be cartoony. I mean, I think he uses it to great effect in things like Die Hard, you know, kind of the stuff that he's
right, and as Snape in Harry Potter.
Exactly. But in this one, it's just, yeah, it works in a whole other realm. And it's just, you know, he is this kind of otherworldly creature. And at the same time, like, you know, Kate, you fool, he's right there. Like, what are you doing?
A steady man. Well, that's interesting because I thought about it too. And I wondered, and now this might be getting too deep, but I wondered if the way that he played Colonel Brandon, you know, I wonder if it was maybe just like a touch of like PTSD. I'll get real deep, you know, because they said that he was in the East Indies and that was like a whole crazy time, you know, and he seemed very reserved and sort of like kind of a step back from everything else. So I was wondering, I don't know his process.
Well, but also I think his whole tragic past, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, they allude to the fact that he was very much in love with a woman of no station.
Their family's ward, which is always like basically like the bastard child or whomever.
Yeah, which is Jane Austen's more tragic work later on, like absolutely went there. I mean, I almost think that it was probably, you know, a little bit inspired by this story. You never see this woman or her daughter, although they end up figuring into the story a lot before it's over. But I think it was probably more his kind of, you know, he had his heart broken in a big, big way as a young man. And that's mentioned a few times. And so the idea that he's risking it, you know, by kind of letting himself feel something for his young new neighbor, Kate Winslet, is kind of a big deal for him.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's part of it, too. So I think it's probably a combination. Of course, actors, you know, take every little hint that you give them about their character in a script and they just, you know, turn these molehills into mountains all the time and then hope that some of it ends up on screen. The lovely, the dashing Hugh Grant as the other leading man in this whole thing, who was just his lovely, bumbling self.
I mean, he was Hugh Grant and I love him for being Hugh Grant, so I have no qualms with his performance.
Now, in the book, apparently Edward Ferris, this character, was kind of emo and reserved and not very much fun to be around in his first opening scenes. It was rather kind of a template for Mr. Darcy, which would come later. You know, it's like the guy that you didn't think was the guy until later. I think Emma rightly said, no, let's cast Hugh Grant and let's have some fun. And let's, you know, set this thing up. Like, aren't they wonderful together? Only so that we could kind of pine with her for the rest of the movie and get it. One of my favorite things, and I'm sure this is all Emma at 0% Jane, is when they're trying to get her little sister out from under the table. And her little sister is a geography fanatic who looks at the atlas all the time. And they start saying things like, you know, a river that flows from Belgium and ends in Wimbledon, and which, of course, is impossible. And, you know, and basically drives this little girl out from the table in sheer frustration over their lack of geographical knowledge, which probably, when I describe it, doesn't sound nearly as funny as it is on screen.
So funny that you should mention that. So I watched this on Amazon Prime, and they have like the X-ray feature, which I've talked about before, which has like trivia and like gaffes and stuff in like certain scenes. And so I had stopped it because I wanted to look at, you can also look at the actors or the characters. And I was going through some of the trivia, and it was absolutely 100% Emma, because they mentioned Vladivostok, and Vladivostok didn't become a city until 1860, which is obviously many, many, many years after this. So it was like a little bit of a gaffe on that part. So I thought that was interesting. Right.
But you know what?
But I love it. No, it was great, and it totally worked.
Word to say.
And I would have never known that. And I also like to say Vladivostok. So
yeah, made for a nice little comic moment.
You know, that little moment though made me think that he was gonna be in the movie so much more, and then all of a sudden he just kind of like disappears. And it was weird that he didn't show up again until like almost the very end of the film, in a way. So I was just kind of like, as this movie was not what I was expecting it to be throughout the entire thing.
Which is good, I guess, in a way. I mean, but I think you do need that romantic leading man presence to be felt the whole way through the movie, mm-hmm. even if he's not there. But I have to say, that happens to a lot of Jane Austen characters. I mean, the ones you follow, and some will make a huge impression at the very beginning and will not show up again until the very, very end. And I think that when you're making stories and movies and TV shows out of these people, you've got to cast people who leave a big impression. The other thing that I loved is when they're, you know, in that initial meeting, when they're at their, you know, before they get booted out of their big house and have to go live in the tiny little cottage that probably has 4 bedrooms. They're talking about how he's getting along with the little sister who, you know, is really someone who was kind of being rude and hiding from everyone just because she hated everything that was going on. And Hugh Grant, of course, was this wonderful person who brought her out into the world again, blah, 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 blah. But they're kind of talking about how she's taking a pretend expedition to China, and I am to be her servant only on the condition that I am to be very badly treated. And it's just the way that Hugh Grant just kind of lets that roll right off his tongue in his kind of bumbly, charming kind of way. I think it was lovely. Let's talk about some of the supporting actors, though, in this, because it's just chock full of so many great actors, as well as just performances and just wonderful, eccentric, kooky Jane Austen characters. And I think this is why people who really love Jane Austen really love Jane Austen, because even people who are just very much to the sidelines in terms of the plot have these really rich characterizations, and they're really funny. And there's a lot to either laugh with or laugh at when it comes to them. So we'll start with Gemma Jones as Mrs. Dashwood.
I love her. I know her as Bridget Jones's mom. Bridget Jones's Diary,
and she was great in that.
She was so good.
Yes, and she's kind of part of this. You know, you've seen her in a million things. As we mentioned, she was also in the Harry Potter series. She just, you know, she's one of those British actors that you've just seen a ton of things from. Harriet Walter as Fanny Dashwood, who is the big villainess of the piece, who could not have been more hilarious.
Oh my gosh.
In this movie.
So uptight, like the best.
So slappable. I mean, you just wanted to slap her face every single time she was on screen. And she actually can be a little, you know, she doesn't always kind of appear as a cartoon. She was Clemmy Churchill in The Crown, if you recall. She was the one who was, yes. There's this look of shock on Allie's face that you cannot see in the podcast.
Oh my gosh! So you know, I'm watching The Crown for the first time, and I'm halfway through season one.
Okay,
it's slow going because it's a lot. Wow! Oh my gosh!
Yeah,
I never would have put the two and two. I just oh my goodness.
And part of it is that this is 25 years ago, and like I still love Emma Thompson, and it's like she hasn't aged a day in my mind, but this movie is 25 years old.
Right.
you know, so this is also a quarter century later, but she's great. Yeah, she's a fantastic actor. But I mean, in this, she just poured on. I think it helps that she didn't have much screen time. Mm-hmm. She could just be the most delicious. I mean, she's worse than Cruella de Vil. She is just awful in this movie, but in a way that is so much fun. Someone else who's kind of awful, who I saw differently than I'd ever seen her before. I've seen this movie probably 8 or 9 times. And for the first time, I think that Lucy Steele, as played by Imogen Stubbs, is kind of a bitch.
I hated her. I hated her. I hated her from the jump. I thought she was materialistic. I thought that she didn't give a shit about the Dashwood girls. I did not like her one bit from the jump.
So did you guys get the sense that she already knew about the real relationship that Emma Thompson's character had with Hugh Grant's character? I kind of got the sense that she knew from beginning, and she was just like poking at Emma at Emma the entire time.
This time I did.
Okay.
Because I noticed for the first time she would say something, and usually I was looking at Emma Thompson's face to get the reaction. This time I looked at her, and as soon as Emma Thompson looked away, she was like, is it working? Am I getting it?
Exactly.
And I was like, God, oh, she's such a bitch. And she knew exactly what she was doing. She
100%.
Knew exactly what she was doing. And, you know, I mean, listen, another disadvantaged girl who gets along in high society but does not have any resources, wants to marry well. Hugh Grant is a catch, let's face it. You know, doing what she feels like she needs to do, but this time, yes, I did not see her as someone who is slightly annoying but probably innocent, which I always thought before. This time, I'm like, oh, you know what you're doing. Like, it was just, and it just little tiny subtle things that happened. Like, two of my favorite characters in this whole piece, and I, you know, these names are not probably too familiar to a lot of people, but you have seen them before. Robert Hardy and Elizabeth Spriggs play Lord Middleton and his mother-in-law. He's a widower. And they seem like an old married couple, but they are mother-in-law, son-in-law, Lord Middleton and Mrs. Jennings, who basically are the landlords of the Dashwood family after they are removed from Norland Park. And have to live in the tiny, tiny Barton Cottage, which is this huge stone house that my house is sharing. They live in the really big house, you know, attached to it. And of course he has a title. So he is, you know, very much of that, you know, high society bent, and they can kind of ride his coattails. They are busybodies, gossips, but delightful. Mm-hmm. And you get that everyone is annoyed by them, but as an audience member, I just loved it. Her especially. I just thought she was delightful. Amazing.
I mean, I love a comic relief, and they were the perfect type of comic relief because they added enough to the story and, you know, sort of moved the plot along a little bit. But yeah, again, I could see like how it would be, you know, if I had to deal with that all day, every day, I would probably not want to do it. But, you know, as comic relief in the story, they were great.
Well, they were almost like, office level humor at times, where it's just awkward, the things that they're saying, because you can see everybody else's face, but they're just going for it and they don't care. And
And I think part of it too is that, you know, the level of propriety that everyone else had to live with is not what we deal with in the 21st century. And so in a way they were almost ahead of their time in a sense. It's like, you know, do you have a boyfriend back home? Well, just tell us, you know. And that's just something that today we would go, yeah, like, you know, you're our friend. We want to hear about it. You're into some guy. Just let us know.
Yeah.
But of course they can't, because no understanding was made and she's not engaged, and therefore no one is allowed to know. And so their constant poking and prodding, like, who is he, is just seen as, to me, it's like a normal question. clearly, they're horrifying everybody on screen, but they're also just doing it in this really delightful way.
So the trip to London was completely off the cuff, wasn't it?
The trip to London, I think Mrs. Jennings took it upon herself. At one point, they say her only daughter, who we're going to get to in a moment, is married. And therefore, she doesn't have anybody to marry off. And this is what rich women did for fun, is they found husbands for girls that they had a soft spot for. And so Mrs. Jennings was on a mission to get all these girls married. And so I think that's part of what the trip to London was. Let's get Marianne closer to her beau,
But I think, so, okay, when Emma and Lucy were having, and it's not Emma's character, actually, I should be getting this Eleanor. Right. As Elinor and Lucy were having that conversation, which was the initial bomb drop.
Yes.
Then Mrs. Jennings wanted to know what was going on, and they fibbed to her. You know, she took that opportunity, I think. She didn't realize that's not what they were talking about. And she flipped it on him and said, you know what? We're going to go to London. So I think that's just a great opportunity. I kind of feel like she wrote that off the cuff because everybody else was sitting at the table and nobody else at the table with them knew what they were talking about, it seemed like, on their faces. So I think that she totally just on the cuff decided, you know what? This is what we're doing and nobody's going to question me. So this is what.
Exactly. But they invited Lucy. So clearly it wasn't they didn't know. Because Lucy was invited along to the trip. And if they really wanted to, they would have left Lucy at home and let Elinor come to London by herself.
Well, and also, during that time, there was a portion of time where the people who lived in the country would come to London for the balls and society. And so it might have worked out. So it was the time for them to move to London for a few months to, do all this sort of society stuff before they moved back to their country home.
Yeah, I think Mrs. Jennings was going.
Yeah.
I mean, the whole point was the thing that was spur of the moment was let's bring the girls.
Gotcha. Okay.
And bring them to the balls and show them the town and all of these things that they wouldn't have access to. Now, two of my other favorite performances in this whole thing, tiny, tiny, tiny little roles, but pre-House and pre-Dolores Umbridge, Imelda Staunton and Hugh Laurie as Mr. and Mrs. Palmer, who is Mrs. Jennings' daughter and her rather acerbic husband. God, delightful.
So good.
I mean, delightful. For years, here's my thing of something that I thought I knew that I absolutely did not know. I thought Imelda Staunton and Hugh Laurie were married.
Oh no, she's married to Carson from Downton Abbey.
She's married to Carson from Downton Abbey, and I don't know who he's married to, if he's married to an actress or anybody that I would know or not. But I thought that because this is the second time they played husband and wife in something. And of course, their friends, so Imelda Staunton and Hugh Laurie went to college with Emma Thompson and Stephen Fry.
And what a college experience. I would die.
Yes, and they were all part of this improv comedy troupe together. And they cast each other in their stuff all the time, right? And so when Kenneth Branagh made Peter's Friends, and of course, he was married to Emma Thompson at the time. She was like, oh, let me bring my buddies in. And so Stephen Fry played Peter, Hugh Laurie and Imelda Staunton were brought in, and they played husband and wife. And they've all known each other for years. Actually, Hugh Laurie and Emma Thompson used to date. So they are back in college, college era. But I mean, they're very funny about the stories they tell on each other now. They really try to embarrass each other, and they just seem delightful and British and coy and fun. But I always thought, oh, that's so interesting. They're married, and when their friends have an opportunity, they just bring them in as a married couple so they can have fun together. But they're not a married couple. They're just old, old, old friends.
They have that chemistry.
Yes, who have that chemistry in abundance. I mean, and so Imelda Staunton's character in this is night and day from Dolores Umbridge. I mean, if you only know her from Harry Potter, this is the first thing you should watch to just marvel at how amazing she is.
Her comedic.
That's why I knew who she was. Sorry. Oh my
God. You didn't know that?
No, I didn't.
Oh my God, Matt. No, yes. I mean, Imelda Staunton. Well, this one, okay. So the triage of Imelda Staunton experiences you need to have. Harry Potter and what's the one where Dolores comes in? It's the really dark one. It's Epigone of Fire. Number
five.
Order of the Phoenix.
Yes.
Order of the Phoenix. So watch Harry Potter and the Order of the Phoenix, Sense and Sensibility, and Vera Drake. And
Vera Drake is so good.
And you will get all of the corners and facets of how brilliant Imelda Staunton is. But in this one, again, night and day from Dolores, because she's silly. She's annoying. She's got this she's a giggly little girl. I mean, she's basically Lydia Bennet from Pride and Prejudice as an older married woman. But Mr. Palmer is so dry and so acerbic and usually so annoyed at his wife. You kind of wonder how they ever got together. And it's just so funny. I mean, the two, they just play off each other so brilliantly. And they're just a delight. And, and now, of course, they're big stars. Mm-hmm. But they weren't at this time. So it wasn't, completely why did they take such little roles in this movie back in 1995? Nobody really thought that because before House, it was before either of them were huge. I saw her play Martha in Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf in the West End.
Ugh.
Yes. And she was amazing. I mean, I can't even begin to describe how phenomenal. I never need to see that play again ever after watching her do that.
And she's going to be our Queen Elizabeth in the next season of The Crown.
She is. And of course, she was, you know, had a big role in the Downton Abbey movie that came out, if that was another place that you might have seen her. Tom Wilkinson plays the patriarch who gets the whole thing started by dying in the very first scene.
As one does.
Yes. And I don't think anybody knew who he was when they made this either. It wasn't like a weird thing, like, why'd you get this really, really great actor to only play this one little tiny scene? I don't think anybody knew who he was in 1995. But it's fun when you, you know, England, there's something about England. Like, why are all the actors there so, so good? I'm sure they're not. But there are so many of them that when you see things, and they also, here's the other thing, they cast, they write interesting roles for older people, and people become noticed at all stages of life.
Correct.
It's not like the Hollywood machine where if you don't have a career by the time you're 30, no one ever cares about you and you're never going to work again. You know, the only actors it seems like that we really pay attention to by the time they're in their 60s and 70s were big stars when they were younger. And that's been, I really can't think of too many huge stars who are American who became super famous as an older person.
I mean, I'm sure that there are some, but
very few. I mean, even if they're more familiar to us, you know, you might think like, oh, like Betty White or Bea Arthur or, you know, everyone else in the Golden Girls, but they were working since forever. And Betty White was huge in the Mary Tyler Moore Show. So, I mean, that was just, you know, some of those things don't count. But in Britain, it seems like you can be a Tom Wilkinson and just be a good actor who's doing their thing and, you know, and all of a sudden become, and I don't know what made him enormous. I don't remember his first big, like, who's that? I do remember the movie he made where he played Jessica Lange's husband, who then discovers that he's in fact a trans woman and goes through a gender transition. And that was, you know, and it was a very dramatic take on that whole journey. And they were fantastic together. It was called Normal. Really, really good. Finally, Mr. Greg Wise as John Willoughby, who is the cad of this whole thing. He is the, not the villain, I don't think. He had honorable intentions at least towards Kate Winslet, but he had a very checkered past and he was not strong enough in his romantic affections. Now, here's an interesting little take. I watched the first episode of the 2008 BBC miniseries of Sense and Sensibility, just to see how the same story kind of played out with a different group of. And I have to say that after episode one, I don't know that I'm going to watch the rest of it.
Was it bad?
It wasn't bad. It was just that the performances were not at the kind of high-pitched, like, Emma Thompson level. Like, Mrs. Jennings was not hilarious and delightful. Very, you know, fine actress who kind of came out and said, oh, you wicked, wicked man. And that was it. And it was that was the only sense that, like, she's fun.
Right.
Elinor, again, good actor. But, you know, so here's the thing. There was a scene that was played out that was clearly inspired by Jane Austen because it was almost the same. But it's when Marianne asks Elinor if she loves
Edward.
And she says, I esteem him. I like him. And in the miniseries, they said, esteem him, like him, and that was it. In the movie, Kate Winslet gets to say, esteem him, like him, use those insipid words again, and I will leave the room with instance. You know? And that's just the kind of level of taking it up to the next touch that Emma Thompson kind of gave to this. She really understood not only these characters, but also how well it plays. Anyway, Greg Wise as John Willoughby. When you watch the 2008 miniseries version, I thought I was watching the wrong show because it begins with a sex scene. And I'm like, there are no sex scenes in Jane Austen. And it was Willoughby and Colonel Brandon's daughter.
Daughter. Oh, that's interesting.
And it started off the whole thing. And it was just like, no. I'm trying to turn Jane Austen into something that she is not.
Hard pass from Eric.
Because, well, the thing is, Jane Austen never even wrote a kiss into her. And there was a very famous story where Emma Thompson said, excuse me, I'm playing opposite Hugh Grant. I'm going to kiss him. Like, that's just, I'm going to. And they filmed it. And Ang Lee eventually said, no, It doesn't work. It doesn't play. And Emma's like, well, we still filmed it and I still got to kiss him, so that's fine. but they took it out because it doesn't work in this. I mean, it's a very kind of, it's not a bodice ripper. I mean, nothing about what she does, and by she, I mean Jane Austen, is at all sexual, really, mm-hmm. at all. Pride and Prejudice, the miniseries, the 1995 miniseries, famously kind of ended with a kiss, freeze frame, the story's over. Like, we've gotten here, and we're done. So it can toy with that. But no, you don't begin Sense and Sensibility with a sex scene. Anyway, Willoughby is a very, very bad man with a very, very bad past who comes along and, you know, is very cute and very dashing.
Very cute. And great course, hair.
Yes. And Marianne, and a great nose and a great chin, and just everything about him is just, the profile is to die. He uses one of those jaw exerciser things. You can tell he's got a very chiseled jaw.
Is that such a thing?
It is. They sell them on Facebook. I get the thing all the time. Yes, you get the
Stop it.
Bite, I want to like, say something else so much, but I'm not going to. He can swallow a banana. That's all I'm saying. Okay.
Again, wishful thinking. But I'm there with you. I mean, right. don't get me wrong. You know, another one of the great little moments in this that always is played, and I noticed it was in the preview, is after Willoughby rescues Marianne on the rainy heath, brings her inside and leaves, and he's planning on coming back the next day. And Elinor, of course, is always so very pragmatic, and she says, you know, let's get you changed before you catch a cold. And Marianne says, what care I for colds when there is such a man? And her only response is, you'll care very much tomorrow when your nose swells up. You are right, Elinor.
You're right, Spray. I laugh so hard at that.
I mean, it's just, and again, that was, I'm convinced 100% Emma. Mm-hmm. You know, again, she knew these people. And so it was just, and she knew how to play against, and all of these great moments really do serve to kind of bring up the fact that Marianne is wild and romantic. Only a person like that would say, what care I for colds when there is such a man? And Elinor immediately is so pragmatic. It's so funny in the moment, but even if you spend a little bit of time to kind of think about it later on, it works. So anyway, Emma met Greg on the set of Sense and Sensibility. And she was an eligible, marriageable woman at the time herself. And
exactly.
He took advantage of that. And he has later on been seen, since you're watching The Crown, did you recognize him as Lord Mountbatten?
No.
Yeah.
Eric, you are blowing my mind today. Now I feel like I have to go back and rewatch those scenes.
Yes, yes. He is Lord Mountbatten. He is Philip's father. And because, you know, he's aged very well. He's very handsome still to this day. But he was that was his role in The Crown. So he's still working. He's still doing his thing.
Good.
OK, let's talk a little bit about kind of where we were in 1995 in terms of, and I've titled this on our outline, Jane Austen cinematic universe.
I love it. It's like, you know, a learned version of Marvel.
She was everywhere in 1995. So here's in 2 years, in 95 and 96, here's what we got. Mm-hmm. Sense and Sensibility.
Yep.
Clueless, which we're going to be talking about next week, which if you didn't know, you know now, is Jane Austen's Emma transplanted into a 90s Southern California high school, which is just, if you think that sounds brilliant, it so is. The Pride and Prejudice BBC miniseries that I've talked about before, right. Featuring Colin Firth and Jennifer L., who was, we talked about her in our last little mini season. She played Mrs. Jeffrey Rush in The King's Speech. And why she hasn't had a huge career is one of the biggest what the fucks of all time, as far as I'm concerned, because she's amazing. Emma, both the Gwyneth Paltrow film and a BBC miniseries came out.
I forgot about the Gwyneth Paltrow movie. Wow.
Persuasion, which was a smaller mm-hmm. independent British movie, all came out that time. She was everywhere. In Entertainment Weekly's Entertainer of the Year rundown in 1995, they cast a model to play Jane Austen sitting by a Hollywood swimming pool and said Jane Austen was the number 10 most powerful entertainer of 1995. She was everywhere. And, you know, of course, conservatives came out. Everyone wondered, like, why the big
right.
focus on Jane Austen right now? Like, what's going on? Conservatives, of course, came out and said, because we want wholesome entertainment about marriage and family.
I mean,
okay, but when is that not true in terms of what conservatives think? Like,
right. It's pushing it, because all of these movies, and I know we're going to talk about this in a second, also feature, you know, like, men and women's shitty relationships to each other, and the fact that, like, you know, it was a hierarchy based, it was a patriarchal hierarchy. Mm-hmm. And, you know, money was tied to the gender of your child. anyway.
Well, and conservatives probably like all that too. Anyway, Matt, go ahead.
No, I was basically going to say the same thing. This movie, as enjoyable as it was, also made me so effing mad.
Yeah, ban all men, basically.
Well, the laws that say that women can't inherit anything. I mean, that just seems to be like, what? Like, you couldn't, like, it would make sense. I mean, make sense is the wrong word. I'm not saying it would be right, but it would make some logical sense. A only daughter, if she got married, he would basically inherit jointly, mm-hmm. because they would be seen as one kind of, you know, entity legally. He would get everything. So it's like, I would imagine that fortune hunting men would want to marry all of these heiresses. But no, if you were an only daughter, you could lose everything to mm-hmm. a cousin from nowhere,
right?
Because they're the nearest male heir who will have to inherit everything. Even if you marry somebody amazing and like you're a like everything goes to whoever. Same kind of thing, by the way, was, you know, at the heart of Downton Abbey. They had three daughters and none of them could inherit the estate. And so who's going to marry dashing Dan Stevens, who, by the way, plays Edward Ferris in the 2008 miniseries. Wow. So it all kind of comes around, right?
This
British universe is not very big. Another theory, though, and I think this is a little bit more credible, said that, you know, there was a time when period pieces were gaining a lot of steam, mm-hmm. you know, and so A Room with a View had been 10 years ago, and it kind of started off this whole thing where all of these kind of British period pieces were getting big. Emma Thompson, of course, was in Howard's End.
I love that movie,
oh. But very dramatic, this was a very different kind of thing. But romantic comedies were also going through a big boom at the same time. And so it was kind of a perfect time to bring those two things together because people had not really seen a lot of costumey period pieces that were also delightful and funny. People had forgotten that there were comic writers like Jane Austen,
right.
way back when. And so it was a great time to kind of bring her up. And in fact, Emma Thompson had been working on this script for years. Years and years. It was kind of a pet project of hers that, you know, she maybe one day it'll get filmed, maybe it won't, kind of a thing. And when she finally thought it was done, you know, after working on it for like 10 years and kind of tinkering with it, she showed it to Ang Lee and said, hey, what do you think?
So have either of you seen the absolutely delightful Austin Land with Carrie Russell?
I have not. No.
Okay, we should. I saw it in the movie theater. It did not really make a splash, but she basically goes to a camp where they reenact Jane Austen novels. You know, she's really into it and it's like her thing. And it's sort of a little bit of a Jane Austen-esque love story. Anyway, it is a delightful, very fun, you know, kind of frothy movie. But I thought about it a lot while I was watching Sense and Sensibility. But anyway, Austin Land with Carrie Russell, it's fabulous.
Yeah, the other one that I was thinking of was Becoming Jane with Anne Hathaway, where she actually plays a young Jane Austen.
Oh, I haven't seen that one.
Who had, you know, Jane Austen had a little bit of a love affair as a young, I mean, at least in terms of the letters that have survived, indicate that she had very strong feelings towards it. It didn't work out. That was a movie that was mostly fictionalized just because we don't know exactly what Jane Austen's mm-hmm. young life was really all about. But Anne Hathaway is lovely as the young Jane Austen, and it's a good movie. So anyway, Jane Austen was enormous, but this is really what kicked it off. This was kind of the first thing that went, oh my God, Jane Austen. But a lot of these things were in development while this was happening. So they weren't the first ones to think of, oh, yeah. let's do Jane Austen now. But yeah, again, she was everywhere. And we haven't really seen anything like that, I don't think, in the 25 years since. I can't think of another classic author whose works have been sitting there for hundreds of years that suddenly we all went at the same time, oh my God, let's do this.
Yeah, not really. I mean, obviously there's been adaptations here and there, and you know, there's always Shakespeare sprinkled in, you know, every generation there's a Shakespeare, but no, you're right. And it was funny because I didn't even think about this until I was reading the outline and I'm like, huh, they all did come out around at the same time. And I don't remember. Oh, and I also remember in high school, I was very obsessed. My friend Jody and I, we were very obsessed with like British men and British, like, these sort of like historical things. And so.
As one does.
Yeah, as one does, you know, because we were the only people younger than like 45 when we went to see Howard's End in the movie theater. But, you know, so I remember that sort of being like a thing that gained steam in the early 90s.
Final thing before we get to our games and our last little kind of moments here with Sense and Sensibility is just a little bit of kind of feminism and classism and like how it all looks with a 2020 lens. Just curious as to kind of what you, you know, took from this in terms of how, just more about the time period, you know, around Jane Austen, not so much about this movie, but like just how women were viewed and how class played into the whole story. And I always kind of wonder with Jane Austen, it's like, are these ahead of their time feminist stories, or are they so mired in 19th century values that they're just the opposite of that? Or is there this weird place where they're both?
I would say it's a little bit of both. And I think Emma Thompson sort of took it to that level and really did make the focus sort of the relationship between Elinor and Marianne and sort of the differences and both. And in a sort of, maybe this sounds depressing, but I thought it interesting that they both had totally different ways of going about romantic, their romantic attachments. In the end, both of them were sort of heartbroken. And so it was like, sort of like, it doesn't matter how you approach it. Like, they ended up, obviously, it's Jane Austen. There was a happy ending for everyone at the end. But there were times where they were both heartbroken by the men that they were interested in. And it's sort of like, you can sort of approach love in all sorts of different ways, but gonna kind of screw you up no matter how you do it. I don't know. That's how I thought that was interesting.
You know, so as I'm watching the film, it just seems to me like, and these women were actually lucky that they were kind of adjacent to high society. And I'm wondering if they were more sad that, you know, that their relationship kind of died and that the women, that the men that they were interested in weren't able to reciprocate at that time, or if it was the fact that that chance to actually have a life has just disappeared. I mean, and now what's my next prospect going to be? Because that is a totally craptastic way to live. Your entire, you own nothing. On your money is not your own. It goes to somebody else. You have no agency to make money. I mean, it is, watching that was horrifying, honestly. So I don't know, that as much as I did, like I said earlier, I enjoyed the movie. It's really depressing as you're watching that film, and that the only way for you to survive is to snatch a man, no matter whether you're in love with him or not.
And Jane Austen stories always seem to end up with both. The heroines always meet someone who is a fantastic guy that they love very much, who also happens to be loaded, you know? And so everything kind of works out. It'd be interesting for her to kind of, if she were still alive, or if I could go back in time, I would love to kind of plant the idea in her head. It's like, Jane, try writing a story about, there's guy A over here who's wonderful and amazing and loves you, and then guy B who's loaded but an asshole. Now what do you do?
Right.
You know, because that would be, in a sense, a little bit more of an interesting take on, like, what does a woman do? But I tell you what it was a life-changing moment for me in the movies was the speech that Greta Gerwig wrote for Florence Pugh in Little Women, where she basically lays it on the line for Laurie about, don't tell me about romance. Like, this is, if it's not an economic prospect for you, marriage, it certainly is for me.
That's the only thing it is for me.
Well, for her, yes. Yeah. I mean, for that particular character, but she like lays it out, like, this is the reality of a woman's life. So you can sit there all high and mighty and tell me that I'm a gold digger, but fuck off, Laurie, because like, this is real life here. And exactly. This is what we're dealing with. And so, yeah, I mean, I think that's just it's something that overlays the entire thing. But I think that even though, yes, they're out to get married and the whole kind of story is, gosh, are they going to get these guys? Are they going to marry their men who also happen to have huge mansions? But I think that I also look at this movie and I notice that for me, there are two times in this movie that I cry like a baby every single time. And one of them is when Emma Thompson spontaneously bursts into tears at when she finds out that Hugh Grant is still available when she thought he wasn't, which is just a great moment of screen acting. And I want to see what that screenplay even said, because there's no dialogue to attach to it. It's all in the performance, which, again, I think that's why actors sometimes are such great scriptwriters, because they know how to give actors moments to play. But the other one is when Marianne almost dies. Mm-hmm. And she's very sick with a fever, and Emma Thompson is leaning over her bed and finally just says, I can live without just about anything, but I cannot live without you. Please don't leave me. And it's heartbreaking. And I just kind of look at it and say, you know, maybe it took a Jane Austen, a woman writer living in the early 19th century, to say, look, these women have very rich internal lives, mm-hmm. and I'm going to bring them in a very three-dimensional way
right.
to the front of a story in a very anti-feminist time. I'm going to like show you that their stories are just as emotionally gripping and powerful as any story about a man, which there were very few stories about women at that time. And I think that Jane Austen, because of course she was living that life, was able to kind of say, yeah, I'm gonna make these stories the center. And yes, they're love stories and they all kind of end in a marriage, but the men are took a real backseat to what's going on. Because it really is about the sisters. And I think too, Allie, to your point, by the end of the movie, both of the sisters kind of have to become each other to a certain extent.
Yeah,
Kate Winslet has to learn how to be, you know, she settles, quote unquote, for the guy who is perfect for her the whole time
right.
by using her head. And Emma Thompson has to have a big emotional meltdown in order to get where she needs to get to by the end. And of course, by the end, they're both happily ensconced. And I love the little hat trick that they pull, where at the very end, you're so focused on Elinor and Hugh Grant's story. And then when it ends in a big wedding, it turns out, oh no, it's not Emma Thompson's wedding, it's Kate Winslet's wedding.
I couldn't believe it. I was like, oh, I mean, it makes sense after I saw it. But you're totally right. I totally did not expect that to be
a wedding. Yeah, it's a great little way to kind of end the whole thing. So it's time for our game, folks.
Love a game.
You ready to play a game?
Ready.
Okay, so here's the game. This is kind of a new game. Basically, it's kind of back to the classics. I was inspired by the Jane Austen cinematic universe.
I wish that you could use that in something. I love it so much.
And I thought, what other classical artist could be kind of a new renaissance for the 2020s? Who would you like to see take over Hollywood and have tons and tons of movies and television and you know, streaming series, whatever, inspired by a very particular author? So name the author and kind of why we're ready for all of these stories to come out now. And pick one of their works and just do it up like we usually do with the casting couch thing and just kind of give us who would direct it, maybe who would write it, but definitely who would be in it. What actors of today do you see bringing this classic author's work to life? So Matt, we are going to get started with you.
I went one for a particular story, but the author is Robert Louis Stevenson. I mean, he's got a bunch of great great stories that you can create things from, you know, Treasure Island and stuff like that. But the story I really want to see, and this is actually because of Universal Pictures, as we keep talking about cinematic universes, they for a time have been trying to create the dark universe based off of all these horror films from their old canon. One of which is The Strange Case of Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde.
Ooh.
Oh.
And you know, in the last movie that was supposed to be part of this canon was The Mummy with Running Man there. Short guy. Why do I always
Tom Cruise?
Thank you.
that was a good deep cut.
Wow. Okay.
The one character that was part of that movie was actually Dr. Jekyll, played by Russell Crowe. He does not necessarily need to be the actor in the movie that I would want to make, which I would want to be directed by Jordan Peele, the new master of horror. I think
he'd be
fantastic. And Russell Crowe would be fine. I'd actually like to see John McAvoy.
James McAvoy.
Thank you. James McAvoy. I knew I said it wrong when I popped it into my head. I don't get enough James McAvoy. So I would really love to see
truth.
Him. Yeah. And that's what I'd actually like to see. Whether it's part of that canon or not, I really love the idea. I think it should be and could be. But I think Jordan Peele directing a horror version of Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde with James McAvoy would be amazing.
Awesome. I love it. Allie, you're up next.
I'm into it. Okay, so I sort of went a different direction. The classic author that I picked is Octavia Butler, who is an African-American woman who wrote sci-fi.
Overdue for Hollywood to pay attention.
Long overdue. And I discovered her a couple of years ago. And, you know, there's so much representation, obviously. And she's a woman. She's an African-American. She wrote sci-fi. But sci-fi sort of mired in history, and especially African-American history. So, there's many levels to it. So the book that I picked from her very rich canon is Kindred, which is where a African-American woman is married to a white man in the 1970s, and she time travels back to slave times in Maryland in the early 1800s. And she sort of has to go back and forth. It's like, it's an Outlander, but more cruel. And she realizes that when she goes back to the plantation, it's actually her ancestors. So it's sort of like a little bit of a Back to the Future twist where she sort of has to save her family so that she can then survive. And at one point her white husband comes with her, and you know, so it's just very rich and very deep, and you know, a lot of commentary on life and history and racial relationships and interracial marriages and the interracial relationships that happen to slaves and owners. Anyway, it's fabulous. So I would cast Kerry Washington and Mark Ruffalo as Dana and Kevin, the couple from the 70s, and it would be directed by Ava DuVernay.
Perfect. Okay. Of all the games we played this year, that one needs to happen.
It has to happen.
That's got to happen. So Ava, we're going to tweet at you. If you're listening to the show, we've got a job for you. And I think she'd do it. I mean, I think she'd be totally on board for that. And you know, in the sci-fi universe, it's like people tend to look at that whole genre as just being really the domain of straight white men. And Octavia Butler has always been this, oh, but there's also Octavia Butler. Like, don't forget this amazing writer who didn't leave her black identity to the side to write sci-fi. She really incorporated it, made a whole new genre, really. Yeah,
it's insane. When I discovered her, I was like, how have I been living under this, you know, white privilege rock? And yeah, I can't wait to read Parable of the Sower. It takes place in the 2020s. So yeah, I mean, it's so fascinating and fabulous.
Great. So along the same veins, I totally picked a straight white guy to be my classic movie Renaissance person. But I went back to Nathaniel Hawthorne, who is sometimes generally kind of looked at as America's first great novelist. He actually is after Jane Austen. When I looked at the timelines, I was like, really? Like, he just seems so much older when you read his stuff than Jane Austen's language and everything seems. She jumps off the page in a way that his does not. It's written in a time you really kind of develop your ear for reading some of these things. But he was writing in like the 1850s. Jane Austen was more like 1816 through 20 something. But obviously he wrote The Scarlet Letter, which all of us had to read in high school.
We sure did.
Which of course was also, you know,
enjoyed as a book.
Yeah. I mean, it's blissfully short. So in high school English, you know, terms, it was one of the things that had going for it.
100%.
They made a terrible movie, obviously with Demi Moore that was, you know, parodied brilliantly in Easy A.
So bad.
Scarlet Letter is not the one that I wanted to focus on. He also wrote The Blithedale Romance and Twice Told Tales, which is a whole bunch of really great short stories. And of course, this is another hit that I will die on. Short stories make better feature films than novels do. Novels are much more suited, I believe, to like the mini series format that now that you can stream things and release all 10 episodes at once, it just makes sense to do novels kind of in that Netflix, Amazon Prime kind of way. However, I did pick a novel, and this is one that I know a lot and I have a lot of deep familiarity with, and it is The House of the Seven Gables. House of Seven Gables is all about, it's about this family living in the mid-19th century, but who date all the way back to Puritan times. And what Hawthorne, I think, was trying to do is say, listen, America, even in the mid-19th century, he was the first one saying, look, guys, America ain't all that great. Like, we have problems, and we've had problems since the very beginning. And while his focus is not really on race, he grew up in Salem, Massachusetts. And so the Salem witch trials were always a big thing that just kind of he saw that in our Puritan roots, there were just some troubles. And he believed that those troubles were still with us. And he created this story in a really interesting way because it's full of ghosts and flashbacks and just these dynamics that just repeat themselves throughout history. But most of the story is focused on the kind of the modern day family. And so there's this old maid who's in her 70s, who lives alone in this house. And it's like a really great role for an actress in her 70s to really get, you know, which you don't see very often. But at the same time, she gets a young cousin from the country who is this young woman in her 20s who just happens on her door and says, you need to take me in because I have nothing. And at the same time, her brother is being released from jail / the loony bin.
Oh.
And so she's got these two, you know, these two things happening kind of at once. And they kind of become this brother-sister pair, almost pseudo-grandparents to this young girl. And then, of course, she falls in love with the man in the village, and the man in the village, they all have ancestry that goes way back. You know, the young man in the village was descended from somebody who was put to death during the witch trials. Of course, her family was the people who put him to death. And so when they come together, you know, things are healed, and American history is getting a little bit better step by step. So anyway, I just chose writer director. Because I was so taken with what she recently did in another big period piece, I thought Greta Gerwig, perfect. Mm-hmm. Like, let's just have her do the screenplay, put it all together. Obviously, the young girl that shows up on the doorstep, it's not even my decision. Of course, it's going to be Saoirse Ronan.
Because of course.
They work together all the time. So I couldn't even take, I was going to do Chloe Grace Moretz. And even in my fantasy world, I'm like, nope, Greta wouldn't have it. So Saoirse got the role. Hepzibah, who's the old maid at the beginning, I was just like, my girl, Glenn Close.
Oh, yeah.
Just because she is haunted. She's got a lot of secrets. It's just, you know, she's having a lot of stuff to go with there. The slightly is he crazy or is he harmless brother, Jim Broadbent. I brought him in to play that role.
I love him.
And then the young man from the village who is descended from the executed warlock, needs to be kind of creepy, but in the end does have to be a suitable romantic figure. So I needed someone who could do both of those things. And I cast Nicholas Holt as Mr. Holgrave. And then finally, the piece needs a villain. There is a relation from town who wants the house. And he wants the house because there's something hidden in the house and only he knows about it. But he's got to get to the house. And, you know, Glenn Close is like, no the fuck way. And I thought, I want to play against type a little bit here. And I cast Ed Harris. To believe this cousin who's like the real villainous kind of thing. Because I think he could play a villain really well and probably doesn't have a chance to do it. So I'm going to say it's a step behind Ava DuVernay's version of Kindred. But this is another one that I looked at this and thought, you know what? I would totally see this movie. I would. And they did it before. There was an old version of The House of Seven Gables where they made Hepzibah and Clifford long-lost lovers instead of brother and sister, just so they could have a big double wedding at the end of the whole thing. And I'm like,
No. Well, now I want to read that book. I'm going to add it to my Goodreads list immediately.
It's, you know, yeah, it's written in language that you have to really kind of orient yourself to, but you're a bookworm. You can do that. You've been there before. Okay. So now it is time, folks, for skip, rent, or buy. Skip means this is a terrible film and no one should ever watch it. Rent, and if either of you say skip, I'm never speaking to you either.
There goes the podcast.
Rent is everyone should definitely see this movie, but you probably only need to see it once. Buy is this is a movie that holds up and you can watch it over and over and over again and probably really enjoy it. Now, the two of you have only ever seen it once.
Yes.
So you might not know if it holds up to multiple viewings, but just, you know, think about it. Your choices are rent or buy. Or skip. I will speak to you again. I promise we're allowed to disagree. I'm just kidding. Allie, you go first.
Yes. No, I definitely wouldn't pick skip. I mean, keep in mind that I did think that this is going to be a totally different movie than it was. I am definitely a solid rent. I could be convinced perhaps later down the line to be a buy. Jane Austen romantic comedy is not really my genre of choice, but this is just so brilliant. It's brilliantly written, it's brilliantly directed, it's brilliantly acted, and you know, I really enjoyed the humanity that Emma Thompson sort of infused into a classic novel, classic script. So yeah, I 100% enjoyed it, and perhaps check with me in a couple years, I might change my rent to a buy.
I really enjoyed the movie. This was my first viewing. I could see seeing it multiple times. But I think it's a rent. Beautifully directed. Great performances from all the people. It was the story itself that just did not grab me. Like when we saw Little Women earlier this year, absolutely love that movie. I love the story. I can watch the story multiple times. It's the story here that just doesn't get me. So.
Yeah. And, you know, again, this is considered not to be Jane Austen's strongest work in terms of, you know, the basic plot line. Also, they said the characters were kind of crudely drawn as opposed to her later works where people had a lot more nuance. It's like, okay, Elinor, smart. Marianne, wild and silly, you know, and it's like they're kind of these polar opposites. And it maybe seems a little bit, you know, it's not on my list of things I need to read. But I think we need a fourth category in this, which is already bought it, which is, that's me.
we should I already own it.
I own this movie. I mean, I bought it a while ago and I watched it as soon as I bought it, even though I knew I had to watch it again to do this show. And so I've seen it twice in the past 3 months. I loved it just as much the eighth time as I did the first one. And it does, I will say, hold up to multiple viewings in that when you let your eye wander, you start to notice things about some of the other performances that you didn't see before. You know, it's like, I didn't even entertain the idea that Lucy knew what was going on, only because I knew that Hugh Grant would never have said it in that way. But mm-hmm. I also, now I think Lucy's clever enough to know he's talking about this bitch way too much. I've got some competition. Let me go nip this in the bud. Anyway, I just think it's delightful. I think it's lovely. I think you are delightful. I think the Rewind Project is lovely. And we will see you all the next time. I am Eric.
I'm Allie.
I'm Matt.
And Be Kind, Rewind. We'll be back next week with Clueless, starring Alicia Silverstone and Stacey Dash.
She was good in the movie, though.
Bye, everybody.
Bye.
You've been listening to the Rewind Project. You can find us on most podcast listening forums, including iTunes, Radio Public, Stitcher, and Google Play. And don't forget to subscribe and rate us. It helps a lot. Thanks for listening. Be kind, rewind.
That's the name of my memoir now. Wooden Hooker, Allie Jenkins, the Allie Jenkins story.